he said, Lord, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. What Moses wanted to see was the brightness, the effulgence of God. Many times we ask God for things, but God gives us what we really need. So God told him in verse 20, they shall no man see my face and live. But God showed Moses something that he could see. And so in chapter 34, from verse 5, and the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by him and proclaimed, the Lord, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin. All of that, God is showing, is his character. That is his glory. In the book, God's Amazing Grace, page 322, paragraph 2, Ellen White writes, the glory of God is his character. In John 17, verse 22, Jesus prays to God. He says, the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. Meaning that the character he developed in cooperation with his Father, he was passing on to the disciples, not the bright light. The glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. The character, he was trying to make them Christ-like, as Christ is God-like. Okay. And so the Bible says, the heavens declare the glory of God, meaning if you look honestly into the heavens by day or by night, you must come away with the conclusion there is a power behind that. Why do the heavenly bodies stay on a certain course? Why were mariners, people who sailed on ships, hundreds of years ago, able to travel thousands of miles just using the heavenly bodies? Because they are always in certain places at certain times. Who arranged that? That person believes in design. That person believes in order. That person works by law. The heavens declare the glory of God all above you. Now, Isaiah chapter 6, reading from verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he did fly, and with twain he covered his feet. Now, verse 3. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole earth. Yes, is full of his glory. So we have, well, let me put it in the same order so that you're not confused. So let me take character out. So here now we have the whole earth is full of God's glory. Now if glory is character, follow me closely, it means we are surrounded by evidences of the character of God. If I've lost you, tell me. Listen to Psalm 19:1. The heavens declare the glory of God. You can learn about God's character, not completely, but you can learn something about God by observing the heavenly bodies by day or by night. The Bible says the whole earth is full of God's glory. As you observe the trees, the variety of flowers, variety of birds, variety of fruits, variety of whatever, the hills, the mountains, the lakes, the rivers, the streams, you realize there's a power. This power believes in beauty and design. You learn about God. Now, listen to Romans 1:20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. Clearly seen. Being understood by the things that are made. Even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. The Bible is so clear that evidence of God can be seen in the natural world that it says people are without excuse. So when we say, what about the man in the jungle? The man in the jungle sees God. Now he may not know the name, but he knows there's a power that controls the leaves. He knows there's a power that controls the rain. He knows that. He may not know what the name is. Heavens declare the glory of God. The whole earth is full of his glory. around you. Or let me say differently, every day should be a search for God. When you walk across the campus, for instance, look out this window. What's that green thing? Grass. When you see a blade of grass, ask yourself, who keeps it green? What is the process that produces green in a plant? How do the plants grow? How do they breathe? Who invented the process called photosynthesis? Who did the plant? How can an oak fit into an acorn? I was in South Africa preaching a few years ago, 2013, and I was staying in a guest house, and then the yard was paved. So I would walk around every day. I stayed by myself, as I like to when I go preaching, and I'm thinking and praying and reflecting, humming, going over Bible verses, and I saw a little flower, purple, about as tall as this, growing next to a little concrete seat or bench. And I sat down and I watched this little flower. And I said, God, that flower is alive because of you. If I have to believe the Bible and the counsel of Elohim, that flower is alive because of you. My mother, when I was growing up, loved to keep plants in the house. She said it purified the air. I have no scientific evidence, but some people say it does. They do. I observed, if you cover a plant, let's say it's growing outside, as it grows, it will change direction. Why? Trying to find what? The sun. Who told the plant to do that? The heavens, the earth, are full of evidence of the glory of God. So what I'm saying to you, in all that you do, you study the teeth. What is enamel? Why do teeth have roots like trees? I had an extraction done when I was a boy. It took two dentists to get the tooth out. And one dentist almost put his foot in my chest to pull this thing out. And when he pulled it out, he showed it to me. The roots were like this. Here's the tooth. Here's the top. The roots are like that. The next root was like this. So they were the flesh. Makes you wince. Why do teeth have roots? Why are they the hardest substance on the body? Why not the brain? You know, the skull that covers the brain. Why is a tooth harder than a skull? And I don't think with my teeth. So you wonder, what is pulp? Why, if you brush too hard, you remove, what is it, the enamel? Why did God design a tooth the way he did? Why are the ones in the front different from the back? Is this accidental? In other words, what am I saying to you, I said to the early group, look for God. There is nothing God does by accident. Child guidance, page 45, paragraph 3. The whole natural world is designed to be an interpreter of the things of God. What did I just say? What did I just say? The whole natural world is designed, meaning God did it deliberately to be an interpreter of the things of God. Now, you're the sciences, that's the natural world. What was the favorite method of teaching that Jesus used? Give me one word. Parables. Give an example of a parable. The kingdom of heaven is like what? A mustard seed. That's the natural world. The kingdom of heaven, the spiritual. Christ would use the natural to explain the spiritual, which means when God made the universe, he made it so that the physical would explain the spiritual. Now, this is true. If that were not the case, Christ could not teach by parables. In the same book, Child Guidance, page 46 this time, paragraph 3, she writes these powerful words: in the natural world, God has placed in the hands of the children of men the key to unlock the treasure house of his word. The unseen is illustrated by the seen. Divine wisdom, eternal truth, infinite grace are understood by the things that God has made. Listen again, divine wisdom, eternal truth, infinite grace are understood by the things which God has made. Now, if the heavens declare the glory of God, let us see God making the heavens, Genesis 1, verse 6. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And it was so. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. Now, he made it in the firmament. What about the earth? Verse 9 of Genesis chapter 1. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. So we have the earth. Verse 11. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed. We have the vegetation which is on the earth. Verse 14. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night. We have part of the heavens, the heavenly bodies. Verse 5. Verse 20, and God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, as the fish, and fowl that may fly above the earth. Those are the birds. So we have birds in the air, fish in the sea. Verse 6, verse 24, and God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth after his kind. It was so. And so we have heaven and earth made by God. But notice how the Bible records the creation of man. Verse 26, and God said, let us make man. Stop spinning around and find what I'm looking for. Let me test your level of genius. Day one, what did God make? Quick. Too slow, that's I. Too slow, that's I. Light. Light. Day two, you should have been thinking about day two, this I. The firmament, all right? Let's just put firm, save time. Day three. Day three. Day three. You're slow. How long does it take you to pull a tooth? 2 weeks? What did you make on day three? Vegetation. I said that. Trees, grass. Day four. Sun, moon, and stars. Sun and its relatives. Okay. Day five. Fish. Yes. And land, birds. That was the birds. Day six, land animals. This marker needs help. Okay, and also man. Now, the Bible doesn't say, let us make light in our image. It doesn't say, let us make a firmament in our image. Yet it says, the heavens declare the glory of God. Which means, there is some degree of understanding of God in the heavens. The Bible doesn't say, let us make the dry land, which was done on the second and the third day, after our image, or the birds or the fish. What am I driving at? If the natural world teaches you about God so that the Bible says they are without excuse, how much more that part of creation that was made how? In the image of God. The clearest expression of a presence of God must be seen right here. Not in the color of the skin, not in the texture of the hair, the color of the eyes, the height of the physical frame, but in the character. Character, where is character? Glorious. So that you, are you a part of the natural world, yes or no? Yes. Are you physical, yes or no?
Yes.
Are you made of matter? Generally speaking, matter made of is what? Solid, come on. Liquid, come on. Gas. Are you solid, yes or no?
Yes.
Name a solid part of you. Your bones, your teeth. Are you liquid, yes or no?
Yes.
Name a liquid substance.
Blood.
Blood, lymphatic fluid, whatever. Bile, digestive fluids, all right. Are you gas?
Yes.
Name a gas. Name another one. Yes. You're part of the natural world. Do solids obey physical laws, yes or no?
Yes.
You obey physical laws. Do liquids obey physical laws, yes or no?
Yes.
Do gases obey physical laws?
Yes,
that's when you dive, you're not careful how you come up, you suffer from the bends. I believe the nitrogen thing starts to expand in your bloodstream, and it's painful. We are part of the natural world. Now, the heavens, the earth, were not made directly in the image of God, but they reflect evidence of God's presence and God's character. But this is most clearly seen in the only aspect of creation made directly in God's image. What part was that? What part was that? You. Which means now, I told you, every day, look for God. But every day, let someone find God where? In you. If that's not the case, no one can find God in you, and you call yourself a Christian, you are living a fraudulent life. What do I mean by that? God gave you life. Thank you. To reflect what? Let me see, this is an improvement. Let's see. Ah, yes, okay, God bless that nice man. Okay, God gave you life in His image. So that everything you do may be a billboard of God's character. An advertisement on the t-shirt of your heart that says God is good. On the bumper sticker of the car of your soul that says God is love. You are the most powerful reflector of the glory of God. You must reflect God more powerfully than the sun. And the Bible calls Christ the Son of Righteousness. Now, that's you. You're studying dentistry. Why? Why? I didn't hear you. Why? To do what? To do the work of God. Is that what you were thinking when you chose dentistry? Seriously?
No.
What were you thinking? Become a missionary. Okay, okay. Why did you choose dentistry? Become a doctor of dentistry. Were you thinking of God, yes or no? You really? You're not sure. What were you thinking when you chose dentistry? Tell the truth. You had no choice. Did someone put a gun to your head? Why did you choose dentistry?
I prayed for it.
You prayed for it? Why?
Because I have no choice.
If you have no choice, why are you praying? I mean, is there someone who was thinking of God's glory when he or she chose dentistry? Raise your hand. You were thinking deliberately and directly about God's glory. Raise your hand. All right, let me ask this. How many of you want God to bless you in your studies? Can I see your hand? Then who are you thinking of? Let me tell you something very embarrassing, but not sinful. Let me take this off. Now, this is biblical reality because the Bible is a book of opposites. Here is God. Here's the enemy. Who's the enemy? That's right. But it's a nice day, so I don't want to use the word Satan. The enemy. In everything you do, how many things?
Everything.
You either glorify God or the enemy. listen to me carefully, by attractive young people, male and female. The Bible does not have middle ground. Most people who are lost will be decent people. Law-abiding, attractive, manicures every day, lost. Pedicures too. You either glorify God or you glorify the enemy. That's why Jesus says, no man can serve two masters. Who are the two masters? God or the enemy? You've got to pick one, and when you make that choice, everything you do must suggest to an onlooker that he is your God, your master, not him. You cannot mingle the two. When you chose dentistry, you should have thought of him. How will God be glorified in my life as a dentist? How will my dental practice hasten the return of Christ? Here's why people pick certain subjects. Here's why. And if you're honest, you'll probably agree with me. And sometimes God comes down at the bottom of the list. But when something goes wrong, that list is reversed and we cry to him. When we want tuition, we go to him. Pray for me. And you call all the Philippines to pray for me. It's really tuition. And you're sick. And you're dealing with a professor that will not grade your paper, and you need the results, and you're asking the church to pray to the same God you were not thinking about when you made your choice. There's a mindset that is of God. There's a mindset that is of the enemy. I want you to function with his mindset. You know, here's what Jesus said in John 8:29. It is a powerful statement. Listen carefully. He that hath sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do what? Always. I do always. How many of you have boyfriends? Raise your hand. It's not a sin. Raise your hand. You don't have a boyfriend? What's wrong with you? How many of you have girlfriends? Raise your hand. Is this the truth? You can tell me. I won't tell anyone. Do you have a boyfriend? You have one. Is he evident? Do you have a boyfriend? Why didn't you raise your hand? You don't like him? Do you have a boyfriend? You have one? You have one? You have one? Yes, you have one. It's on your face. You have one? Yes, you have one. You may not like him, but you haven't. Now, let me ask you this. When you chose to go with that boy, what are you thinking of God? Don't answer me, because the answer is no. Here are reasons why young girls want boyfriends. My girlfriends have boyfriends. All the young girls on TV have boyfriends. The magazines I read have young girls. I need a boyfriend too, so I don't look funny. Or girlfriend, whatever. Listen to me. That's not the way to think. If Jesus thought like that, he would have sinned. He would have said, everyone else is sinning. Why don't I sin and stop looking funny? Let me sin and get along. Please, no. If the whole world sins, I will not sin. Let me be different. Let me please my Father. He that hath sent me is with me. Question for you, is God with you? Give me a yes or no. All right, that's honest. Because I hope so. The Father hath not left me alone, and he gives the reason. I do always the things that please him. My young brothers and sisters, that's the way to live. Does this please God? And the only way to know what pleases God is to study God's word. In Exodus chapter 4, God called Moses to speak to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." In verse 10, Moses said, "O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore nor since thou hast spoken to thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue." Moses complained about an anatomical structure, his tongue. He probably had a lisp, for those of you who do speech pathology. In verse 11, the Bible says, "And God said, who has made man's mouth?" Now God reverts to anatomy or physiology, whatever you want to call it, to make his point to Moses. I made the mouth. Now, if God said, "I made the mouth," what else can he say? Considering what you're studying, Sister Anjali. What else can he say? Too slow. What else can he say? Too slow, you're sleeping. What else can he say? What else can he say? He made the teeth. Am I speaking Greek? He could have said, "Who made the teeth?" Now, if he told Moses, who complained, "I can't speak," "Look, who made the mouth? I did, I can fix it." As you study dentistry, and you run into some problem in dentistry, you go to your knees, you say, "God, you said you made the teeth," and you're right. Even though that's not actually written, but you'll be right. The God who made the mouth that houses the teeth made the teeth. He designed the tooth. Now you go to him. "Help me to understand a part of the physical world that reflects your glory." Now what I'm saying sounds strange to you, but a heavenly way of thinking is strange for those accustomed to an earthly way of thinking. It is strange. So when Jesus preached, the Jews said, "Never man like this spake before." Never. We've never heard this. We're accustomed to the scribes and Pharisees with their boring sermons. We have never heard anything like this. When you think like God, people will say, "Who is this person? What planet is she from?" Think of God. Let me get back to boyfriend. You want me to forget, but I won't. Were you thinking of God when you decide without your parents' permission to have a boyfriend? I know you didn't ask them. I know you didn't. You don't look innocent. You're not. You did not ask them. Were you thinking of God's glory? Huh? Were you saying this? "If I spend time with this young boy, I will have more time for church. I'll have more time for Bible study. I'll have more time for outreach. God will be glorified in this relationship." Were you thinking like that? The answer of my educated guess is no. You look as though you're sorry I came. Are you sorry I came? Ah, yes, you're sorry. But you can't say that because you're nice people. My brothers and sisters, you are what? What's it? Proper one? That's what you are? The proper way to live. Here's the proper way to live. For those in proper one. God, your neighbor, that's it. What's missing? You. Now you're saying, "Now this man is mad." I'm not mad. He's sick. I'm not sick. He needs medication. I don't take medication. This is the system. God, your neighbor, not you. You may say, "Then why should I study dentistry?" Yes, so that you can glorify God by the way you take care of your neighbor. Have I lost you? Your hands are folded, mean you shut me out. That's what psychologists say. You shut me out, but it's okay. I am studying dentistry that I might glorify God by the way I treat my neighbor. Now, if I really love my neighbor, the best favor I can do to my neighbor is to be the best dentist I can be. Are you with me? And so I get a PhD. Not so people can call me doctor, I can walk around my head in the clouds, but so I can be expert in the service I give. Not you. You didn't make your brain. You can hurt it, but you can't make it. And so it is. Then, and that's it. That's what the Bible teaches. What is the first commandment? First one. What's the first commandment? This is embarrassing. I'm not coming back to the Philippines at all. What's the first commandment? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. That's between you and? Second commandment. Don't worship images. That's between you and? God. Say it, God. Third commandment. That's between you and? Fourth commandment. Recite the fourth commandment for me. That side. Start again. Everybody, this is not a solo. Everybody. Well, you be quiet. Why are you looking at her? She's a Baptist. Now you say it. Hey, say it. Quit. Start again. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days, labor, but is the thy God in it? Any work, say that again. Any work, say it again. Any work, that applies to dentists. Thou nor thy son nor thy daughter nor thy maidservant nor thy manservant nor thy cattle nor thy stranger that liveth in thy gates. Keep going. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them, and wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. That's the first four. Commandment five. That's between you and your neighbor, your parent, human to human. Commandment six. Not steal. We'll get to that. Thou shalt not kill. That's between you and your neighbor. Commandment 7. Between you and your neighbor. Commandment 8. Now we get to stealing. You and your neighbor. Commandment 9. Thou shalt not kill. You and your neighbor. Commandment 10. Oh, now. The first four is between you and? The last six between you and your? None applies to you. There is no commandment that says love yourself. They're directed towards God and your neighbor. That's why you exist, to glorify God by the way you treat your neighbor. And who is my neighbor, says Christ. The story of the Samaritan, anyone in need is your neighbor. Because the whole earth is a neighborhood. Eloise says, we are all woven together in the web of humanity. Now, as you pursue your proper one, when you go to proper two, proper three, and whatever else you do, think of God's glory through service to your neighbor. Let me speak literally. Think, how will I glorify God? By providing the best service you can to your neighbor. This then means the motivation for being the very best dentist you can be is the glory of God. And what is the vehicle that transports that glory? Service to your neighbor. Not the salary. Actually, when serving God, salary should not be your first concern. Can God provide for you, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whether therefore ye or whatsoever ye do. Finish it. Or. How much?
Or.
I want you to make a commitment to God now. What do you think that commitment is I'm about to ask for? Is this microphone working? You're not talking to me. What commitment am I about to ask you to make? Reason from all that I've been saying. How do you know what's wrong with the tooth? You reason, you ask questions, you look, you examine, then you come to intelligent conclusion. What commitment am I about to ask you to make? To glorify God in how many things? I'll go even further. I want you to make a commitment. If there's anything in your life through which you cannot glorify God, what am I about to say? Stop. Including that boyfriend. Get rid of him like a bad habit. You know what Jesus says? If your right hand offend you, fix it. Is that what he said? What did he say? And what else did he say? Cut it off and? He said something else. Cast it from you. Did you hear me? But did you hear Jesus? If your right hand offends you, cut it off and throw it away. That's what he said. I thought I said all phones turned off. Is that a call from Jesus? Now, my young sisters and young brothers, here's my request. How many of you will say, Father, help me to put you first in all that I do? Start with this side. Let me see your hand. Help me to put you first in all I do. Let me see your hand. Hands down. That side. Hands down. How many of you were serious on this side? You were serious. How many of you are serious on this side? All right. I'm about to pray for you. Do you have any prayer requests? Loud and loud. What do you say? Oh, pray for your studies. The Bible tells you how to study. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. You take that approach to your studies, anatomy, physiology, whatever, you cannot but succeed. In other words, no half-hearted effort. There is no room for half-hearted effort in the Bible. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. Why? Because excellence is biblical and excellence is Christian behavior. Not just singing, you know, 9 people in the praise team singing 100 songs before the preacher preaches. No, studying hard at school is Christian behavior. Doesn't mean you do as well as she does. You do the best you can. Excellent. So we pray for your study. What's your name? Lara. Hello, Lara. Where are you from? You don't know? It's okay. It's all right. You don't have to know. You're here. All right. Somebody else. Any prayer requests? Lara wants prayer for studies. The most important prayer for your studies will be your prayers, because God is your Father. Go sit on his lap and talk to him. Prayer requests. Nothing from this side? Yes, sister?
I'd like to ask prayer for our children.
Your children? You mean your personal children? How many do you have? Two. What are their names?
Chloe.
Chloe? Who?
R-A-L-D.
Raul. Oh, never heard that name. God bless Chloe and Raul. And what's your name, sister?
Joy.
Joy is a good name. God bless you. We play for Chloe. Who's older, Chloe or Raul?
Chloe.
Sister Chloe. All right. God bless you. Train up a child how? And when he is old? Many Adventists interpret that verse this way. When he's old, he'll leave and come back. The Bible doesn't say that. It does not say that. It says he will not leave. Moses didn't leave and come back. The three Hebrew boys didn't leave and come back. They never left because they were raised the right way. It does not say they leave and come back. All right, somebody else. Prayer request. Yes, sister. What's your name? Myra?
Micah.
Micah. Hello, Micah.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to pray for your parents?
Yes.
So they can provide for you. You don't want me to pray for them to be close to God. You don't want that. Oh, that's a side thought. Okay, this is my own. Alright, okay. You want me to provide for you? As long as that happens, they don't have to go to church. Okay, alright. Somebody else, we pray, Myra, don't panic. Somebody else. Yes, my good sister. What's your name?
Bofa.
Who?
Bofa.
Bofa. Bofa. Yeah. How do you spell that?
B-O-F-F-A-H.
B-O-F-F-A-H. Okay, where are you from?
Liberia.
Liberia, yes. What's the prayer request for Bofa?
I want you to pray for me for a sponsor.
You want God to give you a sponsor? Why?
Because I need to
okay. That's the only reason?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, sister. Okay. Did you hear me? All right. Okay. Okay, sister Bofa, we'll pray. Let me tell you something. I told the other group. God judges the heart. His first question is why? Not what. Why? Someone else. Prayer request. They're far away from?
From
you. Alright, but they're faithful to God. Good health. Are they faithful to God? Okay, alright, alright. Good health spiritually, good health physically. Okay, my good brother. God bless your parents. Something else. Prayer request. Yes, sister. Your roommate. What's wrong with him? Oh, her. I'm glad you made a change. Okay. What's wrong with her? Huh? Who is not? Is she in this room now? She okay. Where is she? I wish she were here so I could talk to her at that point. Okay. All right. What's her name? Don't tell her you spoke about her, please keep it a secret. Okay, she won't be happy. Alright, Sister Ella, what's your name? You have a boyfriend? Oh, good, you're not losing anything. Okay, anyone else? Prayer request. A boyfriend will come, take care of your studies. Anything else? Prayer request. Yes, sister. Who? Oh, good, faculty of the school. Okay, what's your name? What's wrong with the family? Sister Joy is listening to you. What's wrong with the family?
Maybe they're struggling.
Oh, how nice of you. Okay. That is so sweet. Okay, they're struggling. All right. We'll pray for the faculty. Somebody else. Yes, sister. What's your name? Sandra. Hello, Sandra. Where are you from? Okay, what's your prayer request? Your mother? What's wrong with her? She's what? She's sick. What's wrong with her? Her heart. Sorry. Okay. What's her name? Annie? Sister Annie. Heart giving problems. Okay. Okay. Anything else? You want spiritual growth?
For everybody.
No. Do you need spiritual growth?
Yes.
All right, start with you. God will handle everybody else. You know what is required to grow spiritually? But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 3:18. Study the word of God and obey it. Christ's Object Lessons, page 100, paragraph 1. If studied and obeyed, the word of God works in the heart, subduing every unholy attribute. Every sinful urge is subdued by the word of God, sister. Spiritual growth, study it, obey it. Study your dentistry very well, but you don't get to heaven based on dentistry. You get to heaven based on living in accordance with God's word. And God's word says, study hard so your dentistry will benefit. Someone else. Someone else. Any other proper ones with a prayer request? Yes, my good brother.
Please pray for the president.
No. The president of what?
AUP.
AUP, what's his name?
Francisco.
Francisco.
Neoba.
Gayoba.
He got re-elected again.
So, pray for God to bless his leadership.
Yes,
okay, all right. Yes, we'll do that. Leaders are very, very burdened people. No one understands what they go through. Pray for them much more quickly than you criticize them. Pray for them. It is not easy to be a leader. Moses asked God to kill him because the Israelites were so hard to lead. He said, kill me. God, no, I won't kill you. I'll give you the power to lead them. So we pray for President Gayoba. God bless him. Anything else? No? Anything for you? Life is perfect, no problems. Okay. What about you? Nothing. Okay, all God, life is good. Okay. Yes, sister, any prayer requests from you?
Family.
Family. What's wrong with your family? For what?
Guidance.
Guidance. Okay, that's important. Psalm 32, verse 8. I will instruct thee and teach thee the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eyes. Psalm 25, verse 4. Show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy truth. Lead me thy paths. Guidance. And when God guides you, your life is safe. Even if you live on a tree, your life is safe. Anything else? My wife gave me this. It's called a Fitbit. It records how many steps you take. Not how many sins you commit, how many steps you take. So I'm happy it only records the steps, not sins. It's 11, 12. Anything else? Anything else? Yes, sister. Is there what?
I'm sorry to come so far, but I can't hear what you're saying.
A retreat. When will it be?
March.
March what? Are you going? Okay. A retreat, March 11 to 13. I assume it's a spiritual retreat. Is your roommate coming? I hope so too. Okay. So she can convert from that boy. Okay. Let me talk about that. You really hate me now. Listen to Genesis 6, the chapter just before the flood, and the chapter that tells why God sent the flood. Listen. Genesis 6 from verse 1. And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the earth, and daughters were born unto them. And that's one group. We have, let me erase this and I'll let you go. Please don't panic. You have Professor Joy to protect you. So don't panic. Let me show you something. The Bible is such a lovely book. Also a frightening book. And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters, is that how you spell daughters? Were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men. The sons of God saw the daughters of men. Which meaning two spiritually different groups. That they were fair, very attractive. And they took them wives of all which they chose, the sons of God, which are different from these. Their sons married these women. Now, this is mixed marriage or mixed relationships that lead to marriage. It is the only clearly identified sin described of the ancient world before the flood. Now, verse 12 says, the earth was full of violence. God looked upon the earth. Behold, it was corrupt. All flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. So yes, violence. We don't know exactly what kind. But we know that mixed relationships are the foundation of the corrupt world. Listen to verse 4. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men and bare children to them, they had children, the same became mighty men. Now, who are the mighty men that are the result of a mixed marriage, which were of old men of renown, famous men or infamous? Let's look at one of the mighty men, Genesis 10 from verse 8. And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. Nimrod is the one who founded the kingdom of Babylon. He was the product of a mixed relationship. The Bible says when these mixed, they produce mighty men. And the outstanding example was Nimrod. And up to this day, Babylon is a symbol of everything that opposes God. Now, listen to Ellen White, Child Guidance, Adventist Home, page 67, paragraph 1. To unite with an unbeliever is to place yourself on Satan's ground. You grieve the Spirit of God and forfeit his protection. What does forfeit mean? You give it up. You grieve the Spirit of God and forfeit his protection. If you are involved in a relationship with someone outside of your faith, break it off. Today, the best time to stop sin is immediately you find out it's sin. The best time to do right is as soon as you find out it's right. You don't pause and think it's wrong, stop, it's right, do it. That's what God requires. Immediate obedience. May the Lord give those of you involved in these cross relationships that led to the flood. The flood. The power and the love for him so strong that you will cut off what offends you and cast it from you. Here's what some sisters say. Well, can we still be friends? No. No. Cast it from you. As far as you can. Okay. Let me get back to something less stressful. Any more prayer requests? Alright. Oh, yes. He's not Adventist. Is your mother Adventist? You are? Okay. We pray for your father that the light of truth comes to him. The Lord is not willing that any should perish, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. That's God's desire. So when you pray, say, Father, bring truth to my father, you pray according to God's will. And 1 John 3:4-15 said, 5:14, this is, if we pray according to his will, he heareth us. This is the confidence we have in him. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. You tell God, it's your will. My father comes to the truth. Bring him to the truth. Now let God decide how to do that, because it may be painful. But he wants to save. He may not give you money. He may not give you a bigger job. He'll save your father, because you can go to heaven without a big job. Are you with me? All right, anything else? It's so nice to see you. God bless you. Study hard. Respect your teachers. If you have to disagree, disagree with respect. Let that disagreement hurt you to the heart as you express it. There is no biblical justification for disrespect. There is justification for disagreement, not disrespect. Commit your life to God. Let his glory be the motivating force that drives you. Every and every microscopic element of your life for the glory of God. I was in Namibia preaching. This young man, I told him, pray about everything, get God's permission. She came to me, and then she had a hairstyle. I looked at it. I said, when you decide to get that hairstyle, did you pray to God? Were you thinking of God's glory? She said, no. I said, I left it at that. I said nothing more to her. That night when I went to the crusade, she walked by me. I didn't recognize her. Why? 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 She cut it off. I didn't say a thing. I just said, when you chose that hairstyle, were you thinking of the glory of God? I want to look like a child of heaven, a daughter of God. No, she said. Okay. I dropped it. The Spirit worked on her. She came to the crusade that night. That thing was gone. I never said a word. I was in Bermuda preaching. Week of prayer. And this Rastafarian came with all his dreadlocks, you know. Yeah. He came and came, and I preached about, you know, everything was to represent Christ. I never spoke about his hair. The day of his baptism, he went to the back. When he came back, I didn't recognize him. He cut the whole thing off. Just like that. He just cut it off. When he was confronted with the glory of God must be the reason. So this coming Sabbath, when you prepare for church, you go to your closet to pick that dress. Is the Lord? Which one will glorify you, the Lord? They say, none of them. None. Go buy a brand new wardrobe. None of them glorify you. Go back to the supermarket and get new clothes. All right. Any more prayer requests before I pray? I'm really pleased to see you. I really am. I mean, look, I thought he wanted to kill you, but no, I'm really happy. I'm really pleased to see you. God bless you. You're so sharp. You're so nice looking. You're clean cut. You. The Lord needs you. Don't let the devil get you. God, the devil has enough young people. You see them on TV all the time, dancing and jumping and half naked. And, you know, God wants you. God wants to say, no, there are some young ladies and some men who respect me, who don't drink and party and dance and smoke and sleep in everybody's bed. I have some young people like that, says God, and they attend AUP. Let's bow our eyes closed. Our Father in heaven, we thank you, dear God, for your love. We thank you for sparing our lives today, bringing us to this place. We thank you for AUP. We thank you for the leadership, the teachers, the administrators, those who keep the grounds, the security. We thank you, dear God, for the presence of this school in this part of the blessed country of the Philippines, and for the witness it gives off. But Father, in a very special way, I pray for the students. Young, energetic, full of life, lovely in face, full of energy. They are so loaded with talent, dear God, that the devil wants them as much as you want them. And Father, the serious consideration is, who gets them is up to them. Here you are on the right saying, come to me. Here's the devil on the left, come to me. Where they go is their choice. Father, let them look to Calvary and see that while you died for them, the devil is trying to kill them. Let them choose Christ. Let them choose heaven. Let them choose righteousness, their God. Let them seek your glory in everything they do, large and small, major and minor, so that they may be able to say like Jesus, I do always the things that please him. Bless their parents making such sacrifices for them. Remember parents not in the church. Remember family members not in the church. Remember those in need of financial help, in need of sponsorship, dear God. Remember those romantically mismatched. Give them the courage, the guts to break it off for your glory, regardless of how it hurts the other person. Let them spare your feelings. Bless their minds. Bring back to their minds what they have studied, their God, when they take exams and when they reach the level of taking care of patients. Let the patients see Christ in them. Fill their hearts, their God, with hatred for sin and love for right doing. Protect them from harm and danger, dear God, as they travel the highways. Keep them from accidents, dear Father. Let every car in which they travel be safe. And dear God, let other young people come to know you because of the upright lives of my young brothers and sisters. I offer this prayer sincerely as I can. In Jesus' name and for his sake, let God's people say, amen and amen. God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the day. And if I never see you again, where shall we meet?
Amen.
In heaven, yes. God bless you. Just say amen.
Amen.
All right. Clapping is for concert halls. Amen is for the church. Are you with me?
Amen.
Case closed. Case closed. Okay.